I will have to start off by apologizing because I've completely forgot about the roundtable part of this. So I was supposed to get some of you time and transfer inspectors to come up and we talk about this. I didn't want to spring that on anybody yesterday when you didn't have any time to prepare for that. To try to compensate for that, I'll give my little spiel. I want anybody to interrupt me as we go along, please, if you have questions. When we're done, there's a bunch of time and transfer inspectors in the room. We will open it up a little bit and let you guys throw out your concerns and things you think might make the program better, those sorts of things. So I apologize for that, but we definitely want to hear from the inspectors because they're the ones out doing it. We can all share some experiences there and probably some funny stories too. I know I did a bunch of these when I was a county sanitarian, about 500 of them, I think, in about 10 years. So there's always something interesting out there to see. I watched a dog fall right in the septic tank, an old blind dog go right in the septic tank one time. I wasn't a real dog lover at the time, but I thought I should probably try to pull it out. And when I tried to pull it out, it bit me. So I dropped it back in and proceeded to splash septic all over my clothes at the time. But the homeowner fortunately rescued his blind dog. But there's always something interesting happening out there. I did start doing these in Illinois. It was gratifying when we set this inspection up to see that it was very similar to the way a lot of other people do them. I think one of the things that we've all gotten kudos for is the fact that we dig up distribution boxes. And in some other states where they do time and transfer inspections, they don't do that. And I just wanted to harp on that a little bit. You must dig up the distribution box. Probably the number one complaint I get from inspectors is there's this other guy who's not digging up distribution boxes. And very often they won't tell me exactly who it was, which is unfortunate. But we will continue to make sure everybody knows the distribution box has to be dug up. And it's only fair to the guys that are doing it that the guys that aren't doing it be made to do it or they lose their certification, because that's essentially what's going to happen. And it's pretty hard to hide whether or not you dug up the distribution box or not. One guy who didn't dig up distribution boxes and has since had his certification removed was for a variety of other things as well. And the sanitarian went out and took pictures. There's a hole there for the septic tank. There's no other holes in the yard. How'd you dig up the distribution box? The guy actually reported on his report that he dug up the distribution box, which is another violation, obviously, for false reporting. He went on to tell me that he took a knife and he cut out a little perfect piece of grass and then he dug up the distribution box and put all the dirt back in there and put the sod in there. That's why nobody could tell that he dug anything up. Man, I don't eat turnips, but I just didn't fall off the turnip truck. And I wasn't buying that one, particularly since it happened repeatedly. You know, we've taken three people's certification away, so I don't want to besmirch the entire group because 95% of you guys are doing a great job and you're doing it the way you're supposed to do it. But I can't belabor the point too much. I think that it's really important that these be done uniformly. And so everybody needs to be doing it the same way. The realtors and lenders and everybody, they deserve that. The buyers and sellers deserve that. So if you see a problem, I certainly want to know about it. If you don't want to tattle on somebody, I certainly understand that too. Just try to get me in the general area. Usually I can figure it out after that, sometimes with the helps of the county. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the code revisions first, because this was my only opportunity to do that, I think. A lot of the code revisions were because of time of transfer. So we'll briefly go over those. I think I mentioned some of the 68 stuff in the septic pumper presentation yesterday. So how many septic pumpers are in here? If you all saw this yesterday, we'll skip it. But essentially, the only change in 68 is the inclusion of this on-farm food processing thing. And that could be a whole long discussion on its own. Suffice it to say, you may be asked by some guy who cuts chickens up on his property or makes wine or cheese or something, you may be asked to pump out their holding tank they use for that food processing waste and land apply it. You can land apply that waste now. That's essentially what this bill did. Originally, they had a requirement that it be a licensed septic pumper, and some people complained about that, and the legislature took that out. So I wish they would have done it that way in the first place, because I would have been successful probably in keeping this out of Chapter 68 and in Chapter 67, where I think it belongs, which is the municipal industrial biosolids chapter. At any rate, it is in Chapter 68 now. It probably won't move. If you have questions about that, you get contacted by someone about that, let me know, and we can help you with that. In Chapter 69, we did make a few changes that didn't relate to time of transfer. We tried to standardize languages and definitions. Our definition of a private sewage disposal system in Chapter 69 and Chapter 68 were different, so we made them the same. We did renew the general permit for, it's for renewed for 5 years, just so you're aware of that. While the administrative authority, which is the county, has always traditionally done site evaluations, it didn't specifically say in the code that they were the ones that had to do a site evaluation. There may be somebody else doing a site evaluation too, whether it be an engineer, soil analyst, designer, something like that. Sanitarian's still supposed to go out and verify that information. We had a point where somebody wanted another group to do the site evaluations who was also going to be involved in the installations, which I have a problem with. Obviously, we have to have oversight, people who are not involved in the actual installation. Works better that way. Public well separations, they didn't change, but our Chapter 69 separation chart was always a little bit misleading. It said 200 feet for public wells. There's actually 200 and 400 feet for public wells, depending on whether it's a shallow or deep well. We've just laid that out in that chart now, and we put a definition under that chart of shallow well and deep well. It's not what you think it is. Deep doesn't necessarily mean that it's automatically a couple hundred feet, and shallow is shallow. It has more to do with whether there's an overburden, there's clay or glacial deposits or something that would prevent the downward movement of contaminants. So that definition between those two has a lot more to do with that. So you may have to be further away from a well. It's always been in there, we just made it a little more clear. You'll see that a lot of the stuff we did in Chapter 69 kind of meets that definition. We've always used 150 gallons per bedroom, but nowhere in the rule did it ever say we use 150 gallons per bedroom. So we put that in there. Typically these things come up when somebody challenges you. Oh, well, where does it say it's 150 gallons? I want to do it 100. Well, okay, it specifically doesn't say 150, but 300 for two bedrooms, 450 for three bedrooms, do the math, it's 150. It was easy to just put in there. When we added effluent screens, we left the language in there that says you have to have a Schedule 40 baffle, and in many cases that's still the case, but realizing that some of the effluent screens actually replace the baffle, we changed the language on that. So if it's an NSF certified, NSF 46 certified effluent screen, they can use it, whether it fits inside the outlet baffle or not, because some of them will replace that. Believe it or not, when we changed the code and required 18-inch holes on either end of the tank, we still had people put 6-inch pipes above them as a riser. I don't know how you get to that point, but if the hole's gonna be 18 inches, the riser needs to be 18 inches as well. We're hoping to get rid of all those old tanks that have 6-inch pipes sticking out of them that people think they can pump out of. We changed some language, just standardizing language. We used to use the term certified technician and service provider and phrases like that interchangeably. We changed them all to say exactly the same thing. It says service provider now, certified technician. I'd have to look, but it's only one phrase now. There's some new plastics that are out that are stronger than some of the older plastic tanks. So you may run into a plastic tank that does not have a 1/4-inch thick wall. There's one tank that has a 0.20-inch thick wall. But the new plastic that they're using for that tank is considerably stronger than the older plastics. So they've met the requirement for the strength of the material. So, and IATMO, which is the International Association of Plumbing and Mechanical Officials, I think, they have certified that, so we put that in there as well. So if they meet that standard, they can use that tank, even if it's not a quarter inch thick plastic. There's only one tank like that that I'm aware of right now, but you may see more as plastics technology moves forward. Jim Carroll, is he in the room here? He warned me about my language that said, your mound or your at grade can only be X feet wide. He said, that's not a good idea. So I ignored him and put it in there anyway, and Jim was right. That was not a good idea, so we took that out. The idea is that mounds and at grade should be long and narrow. And as long as we promote long and narrow, we should be okay. But the width restrictions I put in there weren't very workable. This is probably one thing that had a few people concerned in the sections for peat filters, textile filters, aerobic treatment units. It says that the administrative authority, which is the county, can authorize the use of one of these devices if a soil absorption system won't work. That's essentially what the rule said. We've always kind of hoped that we'd go sand filter after that, so we added that language. So now it says under ATUs, peat filters, and textile filters, if the administrative authority has determined that the site won't work for soils or a buried sand filter, you can use one of these devices. The decision about which system you use is still up to the county. We're not trying to put anybody out of business. We're just trying to put in systems that are lower maintenance. And until we have a really well-developed service provider network and we can check up on maintenance contracts and all of those sorts of things, I'd like to limit the number of systems that require maintenance. So buried sand filters are great. We've used them for a really long time. They treat the wastewater really well. If you have the materials and they have the space, they should put a buried sand filter in. If they don't have the space, you don't have the materials, those are decisions going to be made locally. You can use one of these other devices. Speaking of maintenance contracts, that continues to be a problem, although I think it's getting a lot easier. Question.
So are we saying then that sand filters don't need maintenance?
Buried sand filters, everything needs maintenance. It's just what can I require to be maintained? A buried sand filter, there's very little to do with a buried sand filter, other than check your tank is about all you can do. So requiring maintenance on those, there's really nothing to do to them as far as maintenance goes. I would envision at some point down the road that we're gonna have some sort of maintenance requirement on every system, whether it just be checking the tank every 3 years or something like that. But we're not there yet. And you guys know as well as I do, people don't pay any attention to their septic systems. And so for the majority of people, if we can put something in that's more idiot-proof, then we should go with that if we have the space and the materials for that. As long as we can make sure things have maintenance contracts, then it's probably not a big issue. And that is improving dramatically just in the last few years. The manufacturers have been great. They've come out and trained more people. I think the counties are better set up now as they've gotten more used to this to track those maintenance contracts and make sure people actually have them. So we're getting better at that. We probably have some way to go on that. But one thing we've done, so someone who does get a peat filter, a textile filter, an aerobic treatment unit, and is going to require maintenance, what we used to say you had to get the maintenance contract before you used the system. We changed that language, says you gotta get a maintenance contract before you install the system now. That way the homeowner knows what they're in for down the road. I've had a fair number of people call me and say, I didn't know I had to have a maintenance contract on my peat filter or my textile filter. And if they're not being told that up front, that's kind of a disservice to those folks. So we're hoping this helps us make sure that the person who gets a system that requires maintenance knows that it requires maintenance when they put it in. And so when we'll be able to keep that moving forward with time of transfer. So if the property changes hands, we now have that opportunity at time of transfer to let the next person know you have a system that requires maintenance forever. And so go find a service provider. Here's a list. and get a service contract on that system. The contracts used to be required to be recorded in the abstract. Well, the land and title people, they hated that. Getting something recorded in your abstract is pretty difficult. And you guys have all seen your abstract, I'm sure, for your property. There's really no reason for that. With time of transfer now, we have the opportunity to make sure that the next person knows that they need a maintenance contract. So we took that requirement out. It wasn't being done, I think, in a lot of places anyway. So the changes to TOT, some of this was driven by legislation. Some of it is just adding more language from the legislation into the rule, the administrative rule. One of the things we'd kind of told everybody about already, but we didn't have in rule, is the time of transfer inspector needs to get that report to the county as soon as possible. So we've set a 10 working day deadline for that. If you can get it there faster, that's even better, especially if it's an iffy inspection. If there's some concern that the system might have to be replaced or parts might have to be replaced, the county sanitarian needs that document as fast as possible, because they're going to be the ones who have to make the person do that. And we don't want it to get sold and everybody to forget about it before they finally get a letter from the county that says, oh yeah, by the way, you have to put a new system in. Whoops. Question, John?
What, if anything, can be done to convince realtors, don't wait until you accept an offer on this house and say, oh, I'm closing in 2 days?
I like the way you put that, what if anything. Because it seems no matter what we do, and all of you have been doing this for a long time, know that that is always going to be the case with some realtors. I have had at least 25 presentations to realtors. There's all these regional boards. I've done a bunch of presentations to them. I tell them that every time. And some of them get it and some of them don't. I'm not sure that we'll ever get completely past that. When I was a sanitarian, we also did water samples for home sales. Well, water sample is guaranteed 5 days. I think the majority of them actually realize that if they've already accepted an offer and the system has to be replaced, they're screwed. They should have not gone to negotiation and gotten an offer before they knew they were going to spend $10,000 on a new septic system. I guess my answer is that we continue to try to educate the realtors. I've done a 3-hour online course for the Realtors Association. I go to their annual conferences. I've become friends with Catherine Anderson, who is the educational director for the Iowa Association of Realtors. We continue to pound on that subject. I don't think that we're ever going to get completely past that, though. Well, and you know, you guys as businessmen have to look at it a little bit differently, I think, than I did as a county employee. But we would tell them that. I mean, we're going to close next week and we need a septic inspection and a water sample. You're not closing next week because you can't do a water sample that fast, or you can't do a septic inspection that fast, particularly if you got to take a sample and send it in. 5-day BOD test means it takes 5 days to do the BOD test. So we'll keep on that, John, but I suspect you're still going to have people that are going to do that. And we'll never get completely past that. But John talks about the misinformation that's out there. And as you guys have all dealt with that too, somebody's told you, well, somebody told me I didn't have to have a time of transfer. I'm exempt because I'm an alien or whatever it happens to be. Space alien I was talking about. But you know, we continue to try to educate people about this. I continue to do Bar Association, and I go to every single one of our training center events and do my little 30-minute spiel at the beginning to try to make sure everybody's being uniform and that we're all doing it the same way. But there is a lot of misinformation. Very often the calls I get are some of the same things you're hearing, John. Somebody told me this about time of transfer, and it's not even close to being accurate. That's a problem, obviously. We do all continue, and I hope you guys can help with that. I know you are helping with that when you're out there trying to straighten these people out. If you ever have questions, give me a call. Unfortunately, if you tried to call me the last couple weeks, you're probably still waiting for me to call you back because I've been gone. But we'll keep at it. We'll keep at it and try to, the phone, number of phone calls has diminished. So I think some of the misinformation is getting passed. But when I go to these realtor presentations, I always get a comment from some of the realtors that come up afterwards and say, oh, yeah, your presentation was great. It's great to hear it from the horse's mouth because I was told this or I was told that. So it's going to be a group effort to try to make sure everybody's on the same page with these things. Once again, we'll probably never get everybody on our page with that. The question was whether the big real estate companies have their own inspectors. They may have a contract with, or they don't necessarily contract. They may have a guy that's a certified time of transfer inspector that they like, that does a lot of their inspections. Some of the most successful guys, and I get a lot of reports from you guys, were the ones who originally went out and solicited themselves to realtors. And a lot of you guys have done some presentations for realtors or met with them at their offices. That's great. We had two realtors get certified. One of them has since dropped his certification. One of them I've had to reprimand about doing inspections on houses that he's selling, which is a no-no. Obviously, we can't have that either. But we don't have realtors that are becoming inspectors. We do have real estate companies who have their favorite inspectors, I guess is the best way to put that. Other questions before I move on a little bit? The exemptions, we'll go over those briefly, but for most of you guys who are time and transfer inspectors and you're not a county employee, if you have a question about exemptions, we like to tell you about them so you're aware of them, but talk about misinformation. boy, and plus everybody trying to fit themselves into an exemption. Oh my God, I'm sure I fall into this one because it says family in it or something like that. We can continue to try to educate them on that too. But there is a finite point at which we have to say, no, you're not under this exemption. Those are the majority of the calls I get actually, whether it be a realtor, an attorney, a lot of attorneys. We have this property, it's selling from these five people that own it, and they're selling it to their kid who's twice removed, half brother of this person, and are we exempt? And if I can't answer it, I have a lawyer at the department who works with me on that. So we probably have covered most of the unusual situations, but there's always gonna be another odd situation that comes up that we'll have to make a ruling on the exemptions. The law always required an inspection at the time of a real estate contract signing. We added that language. It was in the law. It wasn't in the rule. So that doesn't really change anything. Originally, the law, perhaps our rules, said you were to provide a copy of your report to the recorder. We've already told most of you guys not to do that because recorders freak out when they get a loose inspection sheet that's not attached to all the other stuff that they're recording. So I don't think that's a big problem. I don't think anybody's doing that now, but we struck that because we're not doing it that way. I mentioned this yesterday. If you're in the southeast Iowa, south central Iowa, the places where we've got a lot of discharging systems, we require a sample for those systems if you can get a sample. Some systems don't discharge, as you guys well know. If there's no discharge and no evidence that it has discharged, just simply put that in your report. If it looks like it may have discharged at some point, but it may not discharging that day that you're there, while you're running your hydraulic test, see if you can get water to come out. If you can't, put that in your report. But we do need to take those tests. We have made it simpler. We took the E. coli part out. The reason we did that was that a lot of systems don't require an NPDES permit in the first place, and most of our systems, with the possible exception of the buried sand filter, will not meet the E. coli limit anyway. And I don't think that the legislature would be thrilled if we were all of a sudden out there making everybody put UV lights in because they didn't meet the E. coli limit, when the guy down the street doesn't have to have a general permit at all or test his effluent at all. So we took that out, should make things a little bit easier. We're still doing the BOD and TSS samples for time of transfer, because that's kind of what tells us whether or not the system is functioning, whether it's doing what it's supposed to. It's supposed to take biological material out. Another place where we took out the recording in the abstract We really don't feel that's necessary, and the land title people hated that. The binding agreement for a future installation. You guys have probably seen that or heard about it anyway. This is a situation where someone knows that their system will not pass an inspection, and the buyer can sign an agreement with the county that says they will fix the system by XYZ date, whatever they set on that. Wasted money to make that person do an inspection if they know it won't pass. So we've been doing this now for a couple years, and we really didn't have the legal authority to do it, but it just makes so much sense that nobody's complained about it. Now it's in the rule, and we have the legal authority to do that. Since, for you inspectors, you know that bottom of that first page has some questions about whether the person has an NPDES permit or not. We're going to change that. You'll get something from me here in the next month or so, probably, that will tell you about that change and will give you a copy of the new form. I'm going to change the form. I'm going to remove the do they have an NPDES permit part, because people that even have them don't know that they have them. So it's really not fair of me to ask you guys to dig into that. We are going to replace that with, is the discharge from the sand filter, or whatever it is you're expecting, close to a waterway? And if you mark that, yes, it's close to a waterway, and I know that's subjective, but that'll give the county and myself the opportunity to check up on that property and see if it may be one that requires an NPDES permit. So hopefully we'll get, we only have about 2,000 NPDES general permit fours issued now. There's far more systems that probably require them that we don't have, simply because they're legacy systems that were installed before the NPDES permit came along. With that, we'll be able to flag those and try to get people that are supposed to have permits to get permits. The language for the NPDES general permit says you have to have that permit if you discharge to a designated water of the state or a subsurface drain tile. So if it goes into a tile, the assumption is that tile goes to a waterway somewhere, which is usually the case. So if it does discharge to a tile, put that on your report too. If any of you guys has a suggestion for the guys and gals for the inspection sheet, let me know. Send me an email and tell me what you'd like to see in there. I've got a long list. I'm trying to avoid making the form longer, much longer. There may be a time when maybe we're going to have to go to 3 pages. I sure don't want to make it any longer than that. I'd like to keep it 2. Some of the models we used for that were much, much longer than that. I think the one in Missouri is 12 pages. Who wants a 12-page form? That's only going to cause us all kinds of headaches as this process goes. But so far, I've added a little checkbox. Does all the indoor plumbing go to the septic? Because we really didn't have any indication of that on the form right now. And then I've toyed with this language about being close to a designated water. If you have another idea like that, please let me know, because I want to make that form better. It's kind of vague to start with. And it's not intended to be the be-all, catch-all. If you do the bulk of your description in your narrative report anyway, but that form does need to be helpful. In the past, we've sent a document that kind of outlines all the things that would affect how far the effluent travels, whether it's a north or southwest facing slope, it's grass, it's woods, what kind of soil. There's a lot of factors that go in there. What kind of system, you know, an ATU is going to discharge a lot more than a sand filter does. Maybe I'll just send that out to everybody, and you can give that some thought. And when you're out doing a time of transfer inspection, take a look at the pipe, the creeks over there. Is there any evidence that it gets over there? Those kind of things. I would leave it up to your best professional judgment whether you think it's going to make it to the stream or not. Short of not being able to have a set distance, which would be much easier. So John says he's getting calls from banks to do inspections for a refinance. We will not require an inspection for refinance. If you do a time of transfer inspection and the bank is requiring it, if you do a time of transfer inspection, send the reports in, regardless of why you did it. Just like you normally would, the copy to me and the copy to the county. And that'd be a good opportunity for me to plug sending them to me electronically. That would be awesome if everybody could do that, because I can keep track of them that way. The paper ones go in a box, and they have gotten organized now. I had an intern to organize them and put them all in a spreadsheet, but she left last summer, and there's a couple thousand more of them since then. So we'll keep working on that. I tell you what, I'm going to be coming out with this new form, and we'll make sure we have an electronic fillable version of that too. So we'll send that out to everybody. Make sure you have that. They're easier to track. I can come up with the statistics that you've heard me give you before a lot easier that way. If you still need to do paper, you can still do paper. We're not going to throw you guys under the bus yet. Maybe one day we'll have something online you could actually just enter into, but that time hasn't come yet. One thing I did, and for you county people who saw this at IEHA, I'm going to go through the very same thing. I'd like to go through an inspection real briefly here. We'll start at the beginning and go through some of the digging the stuff up and so forth, and just in an effort to make sure we're all on the same page. I think most of us are, but when you get that call from the person who needs an inspection, these are some of the questions you might ask them. How old their system? Do they know where it is? Sometimes you'll find out right on the phone that they don't have one. I got a system, my tank's in my front yard, and it drains right out into the ditch in front of my house. Okay, well, you should probably call the sanitarian, because there's really no use for me to come out there and start doing an inspection with that information. Is your house occupied? Do you have a dog? I had a guy sick a dog on me one time because he didn't want me in his yard. A chow too. I got in my car and left. But start out with contacting the county, see if they have records. Surprisingly, we've had more difficulty with this than I ever thought we would have. I'm not sure why an inspector would not want to get records if there are records available, but we have had to school a few guys that yes, you do in fact have to call the county and see if they have records. Now I realize that not all county records are very good. I was in a particular county looking at some of their records when they got a new sanitarian, and one permit was made out to Bob's sister. And that's all it said on the permit. There wasn't even an address on it. So yeah, I do know that the records aren't that good, and sometimes you're gonna get records and they might not be terribly helpful. I actually went out and looked at a system that I had inspected and made the drawing, and I used to be a draftsman. And I didn't do it right. I don't know what, maybe I was sick that day. I'm not sure, but sometimes you're gonna find that the drawing you get isn't accurate, or the north arrow points in the wrong direction or something like that. We're hoping you guys can help us with that and get those things reoriented. If there is no drawing and there is a system, make the best drawing you can, because a drawing of half the system is better than nothing. So if all you can do is find the tank in the D-box and you can poke out a few of the lines to prove that there's a system there, draw it the best you can. At least we'll have an example for the next time we have to go back out there. You can certainly ask the homeowner if they have information about the system, but homeowner telling you that, yes, I have a system is not proof that they have a system. So you need to see it to be able to report it. I've actually had that happen too. I've had, well, how do you know that this doesn't go to a farm tile? Well, the homeowner told me it didn't. That's not going to cut it. If there's no distribution box and you can't find a gravel trench or chamber or something for evidence that there's a treatment system, there isn't a treatment system. That's the assumption. So take homeowner information with a grain of salt. I'm probably preaching to the choir on that. So. You guys have all been told crazy things before too. We did come up with that authorized entry form. It's up to you whether you want to use it or not. So you're going to want to get in the house, obviously, so you can run some water. That's the ideal way to go about it. Sometimes we have to change up things a little bit, whether or not the water's on or not, or the house has been empty for a really long time. We'll try to get around those issues as much as we can, but we're trying to do the inspections the same way. And we have to tread lightly with what we do inside, obviously, for you guys who are plumbers in the room too. I don't think, and the health department has told me so as well, they don't care that if we're going in the basement and we're looking to see where pipes go and that they all go out the same pipe, or maybe this kitchen sink doesn't, it goes over here somewhere. But if we get too much into the plumbing, people are going to complain about that. that's what you're looking for. You know, here's one of those diverter valves. When my washer's on, my washer's off, we twist those. That's not the best way to do that, obviously, but everything has to go into the septic system. So when you get to older houses, you're gonna find kitchens that don't. You guys have seen all of this. You're gonna find some basement fixtures that don't. If it goes out on the ground, if it's a kitchen sink or a washing machine, it goes out on the ground, that's an illegal discharge. They do need to hook it into the system they have, provided they have a system, or they may end up changing some of the plumbing. If there's no fixtures in the basement that run to it, I don't have a problem with basement floor drains going out on the ground, because we don't want furnace condensate and stuff like that in the system, obviously. Other questions about that? Just a couple other pictures of basement plumbing. You know, my experience was that if they had fixtures in the basement, sometimes they looked like this and nobody used them anyway. So they weren't all that brokenhearted about taking them out as opposed to trying to plumb them to the system. I wouldn't use that shower, I guarantee you that. You guys have all seen some of the things you've seen out there. Sometimes it takes some, you might even need a magic marker so you can mark on some of the pipes. Well, this goes here. Not quite sure what's going on there on the left-hand side. But though that's a nice, beautiful one, although this little tiny pipe going down there, I'm not sure what that is. But that's the kind of thing you're looking for. You guys know this. And you guys know how to find a septic tank. I'm not going to dwell on this very often for very long. So you're trying to locate the system. Obviously, you might have a drawing. Maybe the homeowner can help you out at least. You're looking for depressions and all of that stuff. You guys are familiar with this. Tile probe was the primary tool I used when I did these inspections. You get real good at that. You can tell what kind of material it is and everything after a while. I learned my lesson with that TNT tools, the shockproof one. That's a really nice probe. The new tips on them are really, really sharp. And you can poke them through a thin-walled plastic pipe and you will play hell getting it back out. They did start beveling the back edge of those so you could pull them back out, but I have stuffed them through plastic pipes and had to have the lady who lived at the house get her tractor out and pull it out of the ground for me. So we're uncovering tanks, regardless of where they're at. If they're under the house, I've had them under the house, I've had them under patios, we've had them under tie walls. A guy screamed at me for 10 minutes about how he was gonna have to rip out his $30,000 tie wall because he built it on top of his septic tank. I'm not gonna be the one to have to tell the buyer that, well, they laid a slab of concrete over the tank so we didn't inspect it. We're gonna inspect these tanks one way or the other. And if it's in such an inaccessible spot that you can't even get to it, then it needs to be replaced. So I'm not cutting anybody any slack on stuff they put over the top of the septic tank, because it's not fair to the buyer to not do an inspection because someone did something they weren't supposed to do. So the tank's gotta be uncovered. You can see the work that went into this one in particular, and I think there's probably a couple guys in the room that might've been there. Different tanks, you guys are all familiar with that, but you do have to uncover the tank. See all kinds of tanks out there, the old concrete baffles that fall off. There's some interesting things in the ground out there. Who was it? I heard of somebody was gonna send me a picture of a horse trough that someone was using with a board over the top of it for a septic tank. John Bine took this picture of the dumpster that was used for a septic tank. You'll see a lot of interesting things out there. Obviously the one on the left here has got its problems if it's that full. These are the kind of things you're gonna be looking for in risers. They do crack sometimes, but we obviously want the tank to be watertight. We have had some tanks where people open them up and the water level's halfway down. Did you just pump the tank? No. Well, we have a problem, Houston. Siphon tanks, you want to make sure the siphon runs, so run enough water for the siphon to dose. And you should be okay. Sometimes they get sludged up a little bit. If it looks real bad, you might want to mention that. I was talking to Bob McKinney yesterday about some that he'd seen here recently that had a considerable amount of the slimy buildup you get in sometimes in a siphon, and they can stop the siphon from working properly. So if you see a lot of crap in there, you want to make a note of that. Because it won't back up usually, it will just start to trickle out and the siphon won't work anymore. Oh, this must have been one of Brent's slides. So we're locating the field, again, mostly obvious for you guys. I had a guy make a believer out of witching. I always thought that was ridiculous, but I had an old guy in Rock Island County when I worked there find some water lines with his little witching lines and made a believer out of me. Apparently some people can do it and some people can't, but he must have had an electric personality. There's that TNT probe. I'm not promoting TNT, obviously, but that's a really nice probe to use. Probably the best tool you can have for finding what you got to dig up. Uncovering the D-box. You must uncover the D-box. I think I said that once before, and I will continue to say it repeatedly. It's not fair to the guys that are doing it, and it is part of the inspection. And by our best estimate, 50% of the D-boxes that are being uncovered require some sort of repair or replacement. So we're not doing anybody a favor if we don't dig these up and take a look at them. Now, obviously, there's going to be systems that don't have a D-box. Maybe they got a header pipe, especially if you're along the Illinois border where they use header pipes in Illinois, you're going to see some of that stuff leak in. There's still got to be some evidence that there is a drain field there. You should suck out the distribution box, because that's where a lot of guys are discovering that the bottom of the plastic box is broken out. I'm sure many of you have seen those too. And if you don't suck out the box, you're not going to see it. So keep that in mind. A lot of those, I think some of the companies told us they had some plastic problems at one point, but I think probably it has more to do with bedding than anything else when they did the installation. The question was, do I dig up both of the distribution boxes if you have a dual sand filter? Similar question to, am I digging up every single drop box on a system? I've thought about that. So far, my position has been you only have to dig up the first one. Maybe the best thing to do would be to dig them all up, but I got to draw a line somewhere. And for right now, it's the first box only. And the same would go for the drop box. If you see something unusual when you probe those fields, like the bottom one on a hillside distribution with rollovers, the bottom one's wet and the top one's not, it's not supposed to work that way, then you might want to uncover some of the other boxes because you could have a problem with one of those. A few other boxes, pictures of boxes. You'll see all kinds of things, obviously. The ones that are deteriorated away, one that's a little too full, one that they put the inserts in, the holes they didn't use, backwards, and it pops out and the box fills with dirt. You see that sort of thing. You'll see them bulging. Report what you see. The hydraulic loading, we do want you to do a hydraulic loading test. This hose is probably stuck a little bit too far into that, and hopefully it's not the homeowner's hose. You should carry your own hose. If you use a homeowner's hose and you get sewage in it and somebody drinks out of it the next day, you're going to have a problem. And the inside of garden hoses is very porous. That's why they don't allow them to be used in food service. So if you get bacteria in that thing, it's going to grow like crazy and you're not going to be able to get it out. At any rate, run the water. We talked about the levels in the time of transfer class. Usually it's roughly about 300 gallons. Looking for a rise in the tank, you're looking for a rise in the box, and that sort of thing. So we did originally think with the houses that had been vacant for a long time that we were going to try to do that test later. That has proved to be not practical at all. So if you have a house that's been empty, run more water, but that's the best you can do. You know, run a couple hundred extra gallons of water. If it works, put that in your report, but you also want to put in your report that the house was vacant. and the flow test might not be entirely accurate because of that. Because we're getting houses that are vacant for years now. And so that's obviously going to affect it. As you guys all well know, the weather this last year has probably caused a lot of systems to pass time of transfer inspections that normally wouldn't have, because it's really, really dry. You can only do the best you can do when you go out there to do an inspection and tell them what's there and how it worked the day you did the inspection. If you feel like you want to put something in there about the dry conditions, especially if it's an iffy thing, feel free to do that. But obviously there's things that are going to affect these inspections that are kind of outside our control. Then he mentions some systems that had, particularly it's a system that hasn't been used, where rodents have filled the trenches with dirt. You know, when you run a hydraulic test, that's going to become pretty obvious. You got a fairly new system, and it won't accept any water. That's maybe when we want to dig up a part of the drain field to see. But I have some really good pictures. I probably should throw them in one of these presentations of chambers that are chuck filled with dirt from end to end, because little pocket squirrels or whatever the hell they are, 13 banded ground squirrels, think that it's a badger in their neighborhood, and badgers eat those things. So they scurry around and busily fill them up with dirt. We've had that happen in a few cases. We are seeing another good side effect of time of transfer is we're seeing more systems. We're seeing some of the problems that you can have with the system. We are seeing some chambers that have filled up with dirt, not from rodents, and we're not sure exactly why. Very often it's fine sand that will work its way into the chamber, but we are seeing some of that. Infiltrator does have a fact sheet or a technical sheet on putting their chambers in fine sands, and they call for a piece of geotextile over the top of that. I do have a copy of that somewhere if anybody's interested in that. But yeah, we're going to run into those kind of things out there. Once you put some sewage in that system, it seems that the rodents won't go near it. So you're not going to probably see it on a system that's been well used. I mentioned using your own hose. Hose, depending upon the size of your hose and the pressure, water pressure in the house, you can have quite a wide variety of how much water is going to come out of that hose in a particular amount of time. I actually have a little calculator. If you're interested in it, I can send you. You plug in the diameter of your hose and the water pressure in the house, and it will tell you what the flow rate is for that hose, if you're using a hose. Yes, you can. Yeah, it doesn't need to be something fancy. Yeah, you can do it with a 5-gallon bucket and time how long it takes to fill that up to get a flow rate. I'm not saying that you need to be exacting with this, obviously, but that works too. Ideally, you're going to run it from fixtures in the house, because that offers you the opportunity to make sure everything runs to the septic too. Sometimes in a finished basement or something, you're not going to be able to see the pipes. Usually that's not a big problem, because if it's a finished basement, it's probably a newer house, and the chances are that everything goes to the septic are much higher than a 1920s house. Oh, just a few pictures of hydraulic loading. This one obviously has a problem. The box started to fill right up right away. There's a phrase in the time of transfer law that says the system is otherwise not properly functioning. We have avoided using that language because it could so easily be abused. It is kind of subjective. And I still hear complaints, my God, how can you possibly be having all these time of transfer inspectors be installers? They're just out there telling everybody they need a new system because they want to put a new system in. Well, I know that's not true, because we've been doing this for 3 years. Are there a couple guys that do that? Yeah, probably. I've had legislators ask me about that in a committee meeting. The guy was a septic installer too, the legislator. How can you have installers put these in? Well, who the hell else am I going to have do it? Who else knows anything about septic systems? So there's some folks that think the county should be doing all these inspections. That ain't gonna work. And when we did propose the bill originally with the counties doing all the inspections, the realtors said, no way, we're gonna oppose that, and it didn't pass. The counties couldn't do all the inspections anyway. if you're in a big county, there's no way you could do all the inspections without hiring more people. So the way it turned out works, as far as I'm concerned. And you just have to be careful when you're out there that you're not giving the appearance that you're trying to make money on an installation. That hasn't been a big problem. We got one guy we're kind of looking at right now, but it hasn't been a huge problem. Raise a red flag for them in those gray area reports. It's got a system, it's not technically a failure, but it's got all these problems. You know, raise the red flag there. I've actually had a report, I was given one yesterday by one of my county friends that said all these bad things about the system, and then on the system status line they said the system was working. Don't do that. If you see this, don't say that the system is working. Even if it might, you know, you might be able to argue that it's partially working, because all people are going to do is fixate on that. I had a guy describe all these deficiencies in his system, and then he said that it passed, which is another term you probably should never use. And that's all the lender and the buyer and everybody fixed. It passed. It says right here it passed. But in the paragraph before that, he described all these things that were wrong with the system. Well, it's not going to pass. Or the buyer's going to look at that and go, wait a minute here. This passes? It's got all these things wrong with it? Just in those cases, describe what you saw and leave it at that.
Well, then we as the inspectors need you to back us up on this, Dan. I've seen this more than once where these systems do this, and my chain of action is to call the sanitarian, and then he calls you, and in the end, these damn things get passed through. Now, if I put that system's not working on there, that's throwing the monkey on my back. Because then you guys are going to say, well, it is accepting water, so we can't really do it. I can see a lawsuit.
That's why for the gray area inspections, the ones that are kind of iffy, you should describe what you saw and leave it at that.
But you're telling me at the bottom to not put that system in working.
That's what I'm telling you.
And if so, if I say it's not working, and then in the end...
I don't want you to say it's working or not working. I want you to describe that you ran a bunch of water and the distribution box filled up with water, and that's an indication the system's not functioning properly, or the drain field's not accepting water or something like that, and leave it at that.
So are you saying that someone wrote on their report the system is working after seeing that?
Yes. Well, yeah, that's what I'm saying. If somebody had something like this happen, and then they said the system was working the day I did the inspection, you could argue that it's partially working, but that all the people who see that report, all they fixate on is, you said it was okay. The one that I was given yesterday goes to a field tile. The system's working. If you flush the toilet and the water goes down, if that's your definition of working, then the system's working. But God, don't put the system's working when you know it goes to a drain tile. Denny's talking about the negotiations that can then go on between the buyer and seller when they get that report from you that says the baffle was broken, the water kind of backed up in the tank when I ran the hydraulic test, which is an indication that system might not be accepting water like it should. Those are the things we want to raise the red flag for the buyer so he can go back and say, I want to negotiate a new system before we agree on any price or anything. That does happen in most cases. So it is generally working, but obviously we run into some that blow up in people's faces. I've had homeowners call me and they're complaining because they bought a house that had an inspection and now the system doesn't work. So I dig up the inspection, and the inspector did exactly that. He said, this system has these problems. And then I asked the person, did you read the report? Well, no. Sorry, man, I can't fix stupid. If you're gonna get a report on your septic system and you don't bother to read it, one report said, Dan Olson at the DNR may make you replace this system, which I'd leave my name off it, please, man. Because that's going to be the county guy who's going to make them do that. But that person had the same situation. They called up and said, my system failed. We just had an inspection. Your time of transfer program sucks. Did you read the report? It says that the system may have to be replaced. Well, yeah. well, what did you think that meant? I can't protect you from yourself. So it's not gonna fix everybody. But he mentioning a disclaimer that he's putting on his, we have a short disclaimer on the inspection form itself. You are free to write whatever disclaimer you want on your report or on your narrative report or something like that, because that is in fact the case. We're telling them how the system works the day that we're there. And that doesn't mean that it's gonna work next week the same way, or tomorrow for that matter. So we can provide, we need to provide these people with as much information as we can give them when we're out there looking at this system, but they still have some responsibility to look at that report. And if they don't understand what it says, they need to call somebody. They need to call the county. They need to call the inspector. They need to call me, so we can explain to them what that means, which is most people, as you guys well know, do not understand what we're telling them in their report because they don't know anything about septic systems. So there still is some responsibility incumbent upon the buyer that they should be looking at these reports critically. I think that will improve as we go on because the education level about septic systems is going up rather rapidly because of time of transfer. Never gonna be perfect again. We're never gonna get everybody to do it that way, but it is getting better. The seller is responsible in law to give a copy of the report to the buyer. The question was, we're just clarifying who gets the report. I get a copy of the report. The purpose for me to get a copy of the report is to be able to police the inspectors and make sure everybody's doing it the same way. The county gets a copy of the report because they're the ones that are going to decide whether the system needs repairs or replacement. Otherwise, you're giving a copy of the report to the person that ordered it from you. The law says that the seller has to provide a copy to the buyer. Nobody's checking up on that. And I don't have a method to check up on that.
I was just curious.
No, that's fine. That's a very good question. But people need to be more involved in this. The vast majority of the real estate people are good folks, and they're going to make sure that everybody involved has a copy of this report. Probably a good reason not to have the same realtor be the buyer and seller's realtor. If you have a realtor as a buyer, the chances of you getting that report are going to be a whole lot higher because they're looking out for you as the buyer. And that's maybe so much strictly as just the seller. And Ken was adding that he's seen people not, buyers not get the reports as well. We'll take a look and see if there's somewhere along the line we can try to make sure that that happens. But very often we were just talking about these people waiting to the last minute. I do get people that call and say, well, how long is the inspection good for? Well, 2 years. Well, they go ahead and have the inspection now. They don't even have a buyer. Or they maybe don't even have put it on the market yet. But somewhere along the line, there may be an opportunity. We'll look at that and see if we can raise the chances that the buyer is going to see the thing. Now, everybody who's bought a house here knows how many papers in that stack when you go to your lawyer to sign your life away for your house or your home mortgage. I can't help it if the people don't pay attention to the forms that they're signing or looking at. Again, we'll do the best we can, but the buyer still has to try to be a little responsible here. Yeah, the question was about the form, and maybe we could, because we very often don't know who the buyer is, maybe we can put on that form that the seller's responsible to provide a copy, and that would very likely increase the chances that the buyer's gonna get it anyway. It's probably not gonna guarantee it, but it would increase chances. I'm good with that. The question is it your obligation as an inspector to send out multiple copies to everybody who's involved in the sale? And the answer is no. You are only required to provide a copy to me, to the county, and to the person who ordered the inspection. It is public record. It's a lot easier to get it from you or from the county for them to call and get it from me. Because if it's paper record, I got to dig through two or three boxes to try to find it. But you're not required to. So, but as a public service, or so you make people happy and you'll get that next job too, if somebody else asks you for it, give them a copy. It's a public record. A little bit of dye testing. You can charge them a reasonable fee, is what the public records law says. dye testing, this was a situation where they had an overflow pipe, and it went from that distribution box to this culvert that was in the road. There was just one too many lines, I think, in there. It got the guy wondering, hey, where's that line go? It's not on the drawing. This is down in an area that probably shouldn't have any soil absorption systems anyway. So if you're in that southeast part of the state and someone gives you a map of a system that's a soil absorption system, I would look at that system very critically. Because if it's in Jefferson County or Washington County or one of those counties that has pretty much all poor soils, a soil absorption system ain't gonna work. So if it does work, they've done something like this to make it work. Yes, and Brian, I think that's your picture actually. We've kind of talked about this. Obviously, if there's effluent on the ground, the system's considered a failure. So you want to report that there was effluent on the ground. You probe, you know, you can get a good idea of what condition the system's in when you pull the probe out. It's covered with sludge, something like that. You want to report that. When I probed the field, you know, here's another system that's not bleeding out on top of the ground, but I probed the field. When I pulled it out, water shot out of the hole. It's obviously a sign that the system's under hydraulic pressure. So you want to say something like that in your report. Let's see, just all I want to say here is that, you know, we have to have some evidence that there's a drain field or a secondary treatment system in order to for the system to pass. If there's no evidence that there's a system, there isn't one. If the homeowner wants you to dig holes all over his yard to find the system that he thinks he has, he's free to do that. But at some point, it's going to become cost prohibitive, and they should probably just put thousands of dollars worth of excavating costs into that new system. We've covered most of that. And we've talked about the reporting. More information is always better. So if it gets long like that, there's nothing wrong with that. You've covered your bases. Some of the guys will put recommendations on the bottom about pumping your tank with some frequency, cleaning your effluent screen, something like that. That's great. That's good education for homeowners. Briefly wanted to talk about exemptions. We got 6 minutes left. The ones that come up the most are the foreclosure exemption. It's all about where the deed is. The deed is held by Joe Citizen. He defaults on his mortgage. The deed goes to the bank. That deed transfer is exempt. The bank then sells the house to someone else. That deed transfer is also exempt. So keep that in mind. If it changes hands more than that, it's not exempt anymore. The other one that comes up a lot is the estate one. It's got to be a decedent. So people cannot put their house in a living trust to avoid an inspection if no one has died. It has to be the estate of a decedent. And that deed can transfer from that estate to anyone. Doesn't have to be a family member, and it's exempt. That exemption is very often confused with the lineal line of consanguinity, my new favorite word. It doesn't have to be a family member for the estate. Keep that in mind. And the key phrase for the lineal line is, in fact, the lineal line part. Consanguinity just means blood relative. Lineal line means generation to generation. Grandparents to parents to children. It can go in either direction, and it's exempt. If it's in a corporation that's owned by mom and dad, and they're gonna give it to their kid, that is not exempt, because it's not family, it's a corporation. They could change it to their family name, which would be exempt under that really long exemption that talks about LLCs and all of that crap, and then they could transfer it to their kid if they wanna do that, but I don't offer that up. I don't offer exemptions up at all. If people want to do inspections, they should do inspections. And I always tell the buyer, just because it's exempt doesn't mean that it cannot be inspected. You should ask for an inspection, whether it falls under one of the exemptions or not. That is an extra step that we have said it makes it no longer exempt. However, the federal government thinks they can do whatever they want, and they think the state laws don't apply to them. And they've pretty much ignored us. So honestly, I've given up on that. We have advised them to make the deed transfer directly to Fannie Mae and leave the bank out of the middle. I don't know enough about home mortgaging to know whether that's possible or not. But technically, when Fannie Mae gets it, as the third person now who's owned gets the deed, they're not exempt. But it would appear that I'm not going to win that battle, because our legal department is not going to fight the federal government over this. I would love to, but it could take an awful lot of time. Some of these other ones that don't come up very often, I think you guys are familiar with. This is that long one I was talking about. This essentially says you can change from an S-Corp to an LLP and not have to have an inspection. Now, the question was, is there anything looming legislatively that would get rid of the exemptions? Is that the correct? That will not happen. These exemptions are here because somebody that was involved in the crafting of this bill wanted them there. And without them, the bill would have never passed. Now, there are exemptions that one group wanted. That's how it got in there. The bankers wanted this one. The realtors hate it. But the realtors realize that if they go to the legislature and say, we want this exemption gotten rid of, that they may lose the one they want, too. So I don't see that there's going to be any effort. As a matter of fact, I would expect if there's any effort that deals with these exemptions that someone would try to add more of them, given the current climate. The last 2 years, keep that in mind. If they got a new system that's 2 years or older or less, they do not have to have an inspection. They do have to have a permit to show that it was a permitted system. And it's 2 years, solid 2 years, not 2 years in a day. It's not 2 years in an hour. It's 2 years. Some of these time frames, I realize, seems unreasonable that it's one day, you're 1 day late, but a line in the sand is a line in the sand, and I can't say that it's 1 day. The next person says, okay, it's 2 days, and then it's a week, and then it's a month. Those timelines are solid. You guys are probably familiar with these binding agreements. We talked about the future installation one. They're going to demolish a house. They can sign that with the county, and they don't have to have an inspection. The weather-related only for that future inspection. We've had attorneys or realtors call up, like you were mentioning, John, my closing's next week, and we forgot to have the inspection. Can we use the binding agreement for a future inspection? No, you cannot. It has to be weather-related. Either the ground is frozen or you're underwater have been the two situations where we've used that. The question is whether you need two, you could possibly have two binding agreements for the same sale. The situation was that they're going to demolish the house and build a new one. You probably don't need the binding agreement for the future installation because there's already a clause in Chapter 69 that says that you have to have a new system for a new house. Or if you're going to hook up a building to an existing system, that system has to meet today's code. So we already have that in the rule, so you probably didn't need the future inspection one. It's not a big deal. But.